that's your key to the whole thing. These controllers are interrupt driven, so everything happens on interrupt. Anything. Like, you want to talk to these chips, you're saying, how do I structure things?
Yeah.
So, see, well, how it works is they have a fixed structure in RAM somewhere, some DMAable RAM. You organize it the way they like, the chip likes it, put little pointers in there, things. And then you go command, create your command again in RAM, and then you say, okay, I have a command, and you pound, you write to an IO address, say, go get it. And somehow, I can't remember how you address it, it goes to that place in RAM, grabs it, and starts running. And when it's done, it goes beep, interrupt. I'm done, come and get it,
right?
It's like a microwave. Bing. And this is the function that pulls the data out of your command.
Okay.
That's how it starts. So there's kind of, there's a key input and a key output. And once you know those, the rest is easy. You're just sending commands to the device, pulling the data back. But it's all asynchronous. That's why I needed a task, AmigaKit task, to monitor it. And that's where I ran into spin lock hell as well. This is where you see I have spin lock turned off. Ooh. See, what I did was I didn't want to do it the Linux way, which was run everything on interrupt context. For whatever reason, they like that. I went, okay, I'm going to run everything on a Amiga task context and do a switch. My worry was the code would break, nothing would run fast, blah, blah, blah. Sebastian said, nah, it'll be fine. And I argued with him for like 6 months or something. And I finally gave in and rewrote it his way to get it off of interrupt context. Everything started working perfectly. So you've heard. Sometimes you're wrong. So, but you wouldn't know to do this if you're starting brand new, right? They did it that way. That must be the right way. You follow them, right? Well, that's not the right way for Amiga. So sometimes there's going to be these decisions that pop up that say, even though they did it that way, that's not the right way for our system. We have to get off of interrupt context, run it in normal process space. Because we were just taking forever to go through all that code. And by the time I came back, the OS is like, where have you been? our round robin scheduler is like, we don't have the fanciest schedulers, right? Where have you been, man? You've been gone for like 600 milliseconds. Oh, it was interesting. Init controller, there's your init. There it is. You were asking about init.
Indeed.
Yeah. There's all the specifics from whoever read the data sheet. Not my code. All original Linux code. I didn't do anything. I didn't have to go 0100 to HDR base plus ICC. I don't even know what that means. I don't care. It just works. Now, Jamie, he had to go through on the Ethernet and figure out every single thing was what it meant. Right?
Yeah.
I didn't have to.
In Freescale language, is HCR hardware control register?
Host
control
host,
register.
Host. Host is the word. Yeah.
All right.
HCR base, that's the host. They called it a host for some reason.
That's fine. All right, so basically all their setup registers start at a particular base address, and you have offsets to which?
Yep, everything's got the master CCSR base.
Yeah,
that's where all of the configurations.
The ACR base is based off of that base.
Yep.
Yeah.
Just tracking down whether,
and that's another matter,
whether the implementation of these machines
use
the same base, because it's programmable.
Yeah.
That was tricky.
Yeah, that's when I went to U-Boot.
Yeah. It's like, how do you know? Yeah, that's the same thing.
Yep. I went to
a
you.
A lot of searching just to find out, oh, it's the default.
Yep.
They didn't change it.
Yeah.
But you can, I literally scan through the memory, finding identifiable registers.
Yeah.
And tracing back, going, it must be the default.
Yes.
Because this is supposed to look like
yes.
this.
Yes, yes, yes.
That was ridiculous.
There's two key pieces, I think it was, the base addresses and the interrupt number.
Yeah. Right. Where do you start?
It should be in a header file.
Yes.
They're not?
No.
So,
okay. Well, he's in shock.
They are literally in my framework.
No, I mean, HCR base, you got to trace that back somewhere.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Everything is add from the base to the section, to the base, to the register. It's add, add, add.
So there's something eventually you go back to.
Yeah.
Okay. You have to know where it starts.
And it comes from user. Because it's, like you said, it's programmable.
Programmable.
Firmware chooses it.
It can move. Moves.
Oh, fudge.
Yes. Oh, fudge.
Okay.
But on these machines, they use the phone. Which was.
Oh, thank you.
You're welcome.
It just took a long time to verify that.
Yeah.
Ridiculous amounts of time to verify.
Yeah.
It's not even printed in the
documentation. This is why. When Jamie was first starting
it's
out.
It's in all the data sheets in Freescale, but it says this is the default, it can be changed.
Well,
so no documentation to say, on these machines, what did they set it to?
Yeah, on these particular boards.
All the register documentation, it just gives you offsets.
Offsets.
It's all offsets.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are no absolute addresses there.
And you know, Verisys is pretty tight on information. So I didn't even bother emailing them. I just went to U-Boot and saw what they programmed because they can't lie there. So, I know
don't
what
you own the IP
in.
Of what you paid for? Sorry? Don't you guys own the IP of what you paid for? Versus doesn't retain any rights to the design, do they? I'm sorry?
They did prior.
Really? Okay. Then how that contract did it?
For ODM arrangements.
Sorry?
Never mind. We'll talk on the cameras. Okay.
So, yeah, it was quite a challenge when Jamie, like I was going to say, when we started the Ethernet driver, I found out you were going to start working on it. I said, stop. I have to talk to you. Remember?
Yes.
I said, stop. I must talk to you.
You're sitting on your living room floor with nothing because you just moved.
Yeah, I was on my living room floor trying to Skype with Jamie. Don't do anything. I have to tell you some critical bits of information. The base address and the interrupt number.
Yeah.
And then a basic AmigaOS device framework thing. But yeah, he couldn't do a thing without those two key pieces, right? And he was trying. You were starting to dig.
I was.
You were
digging.
And you were probably spinning and having all sorts of fun. So.
I was absorbing
more
about the.
But you didn't need to know all that, but you do and you don't. I just wanted to kickstart you. Get you going.
Yeah. No, it was a complete showstopper. It was a complete brick wall.
Yeah.
Without that information. Can't be done.
So I don't want to do that to everybody.
Right.
I'm a busy guy. So.
And how do they know to ask?
They don't.
Oh, right.
So I want to add a new header file for whatever new hardware comes along where we put this up for AmigaOS driver writers. Has it in there. What a concept. Well, Linux already has it, of course.
Yes.
Yeah. But their system is beyond what we need for complexity.
Way beyond.
You know how many platforms that runs on it?
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
And it's got so many layers, your head starts to spin. I mean, it's great. It's configurable. Oh.
That's why I have a real hesitation bringing in blocks of straight up Linux code. It's like, no, I don't want this extra dead weight. I just want the direct, elegant Amiga method.
Well, even IO Write 32 was four layers deep before I found it.
Yeah.
Starts with a macro, and it goes to another macro, and it goes over here, and then it goes over there, and then it ifdefs there, and then it does this.
Yeah. And my framework, I put it in a single header file machine. It's underneath the hardware layer, there was a subdirectory CPU.
Yeah.
And in there is that magic macro assembly for all of the reads and writes of
yes.
the registers.
Yes.
Which and that's essential.
Something I want to show off, actually. Now you mentioned it. Kernel?
Kernel. I had to make a kernel tree. So this is this is Linux kernel.
Yeah.
This is the Amiga kernel. This is Linux kernel. These are the pieces of the Linux kernel you need to avoid rewriting. It's like a sublayer, like DNA mapping.c is atomic.c. Those are Linux files.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, this is my version of it. Doesn't do a heck of a lot. I took the Linux file and stripped out everything and just all I needed was one prototype. So I said, oh, it's my project. Here's another one. Right? And I just subbed the routines. There's my io.s function. So I lied a little bit. I did a little bit of assembly. I had to.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right? For io read 32, after going through all that, I found out I just need sync block blur.
Mm-hmm. I have all the banks, all the variations of them for reading and writing 16, 32, and it's all
ASCII.
I think most of them are BSD.
You found it in BSD,
yeah.
But it's all the same stuff.
Yeah, you find that they're doing the same basic thing for all of the different ones. It's pretty much just make sure you sync.
Yeah.
Then do it.
But the thing I had no clue about is what LD probably does know.
Yeah, these are what
sync is for and what iSync is for.
These are ugly ops.
I don't care. I just want it to work.
For atomic operation, layer operation.
Yes.
Right? You get to do your marks and stuff. There's a very nice write up on these guys. There's a whole section of them in the ISA doc. That's useful. It'll talk about sync and EIE, EIO, and marks and stocks and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And it's useful to read through because the storage architecture for Power is not as straightforward as some other architectures like MIPS or.
I found it highly confusing.
It is highly confusing.
So I'm just copying what other people did.
Okay. I love the name of that one for the sync. What is that one called? Oh yeah, EIEIO.
Yeah.
The farmer one.
That's what it is.
I was thinking exactly the same thing, but I was gonna be quiet.
Oh no, that's been a joy to remember that invented.
Yeah. That sync is really expensive in hardware terms. It's Yeah.
See, I don't know.
Yeah.
And these are used quite a bit.
A lot,
But the thing is
I need to understand more about what the goal of course is to use the smallest
possible
one.
Yeah, 100%, because this stuff is very expensive
yeah.
in terms of cycles.
Well, the nice thing about this controller is, like I said, it's asynchronous, it's all DMA interrupt driven. So this is expensive, but then you set it off and it just goes.
And it's relatively rare that you're going to be doing this, hopefully.
Well, every command.
Oh, well, right.
Every command you queue, you have to go through
that. Yeah, you do. Because
now, fortunately, you don't want to spin on anything, so you don't have to do this. You know, imagine if you did a spin on IO read 32 in the system. You'd kill it.
Yes.
Right? But it's interrupt driven, so you're okay. Performance doesn't suffer. You can see it's a delicate balance. I don't even know if these are absolutely right, but they're like fifth generation now of things I've tried. When I was desperately looking for that bug,
I
thought maybe it's my IO. I don't know, right?
That sync's going to throw away a whole pile of stuff.
Oh, there's an old version.
Yeah.
I mean, it's... Oh, there's EIEIO.
Yeah.
There's
my boy.
See, there's an old version I had.
Yeah.
Where I was doing the swap with a macro, and then I discovered, I think that last year, you said, well, there's a PowerPC instruction to swap it for me.
Yeah.
And I went, there is?
Slightly faster.
Well, maybe I should go fix that. So I found it. Yeah, that's why the new one does the swap for you.
Yeah.
It's like, well, how convenient. I'm not used to hardware people giving.
That's what we're here for, man.
Usually they take it away.
Oh, yeah.
Hardware, yeah. You know, well, I'm a firmware programmer.
You're
so
a firmware guy.
I'm used to abuse, right? Hardware people. this is cute. So I wrote my own Jiffy's functions. You need Jiffy's in Linux world to get anything done for timing. So I made my own, and it interfaces to the timer device. Right?
That's beautiful.
Yes.
Very nice.
Done. Right? Done. No more screwing around. It wasn't that hard, but somebody had to do it.
I have a general question for you about your driver.
Yeah.
Does it make, to what extent does it make use of OS4 specific subsystems?
As minimal as possible.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, memory, yes.
Right.
Interrupts, yes. I had to talk to AmigaOS. The rest of it, I've been trying to make a thin kernel layer. Like, this is my kernel replacement for the Linux kernel. Try to use their API and just slip in little functions.
Mm-hmm. And you see where I'm going with this, right? I mean, it seems only logical to attempt to see if this can be made to work on a classic environment.
I don't see why not. I mean, if you just replace the kernel stuff
right.
that I wrote
right.
with classic stuff.
Just modify the shim.
Done, yeah. Right? Yeah, shim, that's the word, yeah. It's a wrapper, it's a shim, it's thin.
That would be something
really
worth funding.
I think it's worth a shot. I don't see why not. Right? I got my own print kernel function, you know. Completions. These are tricky. I had to rewrite the completion API. Because in Linux they have completions. Oh, kind of a rendezvous mechanism. So you see I have complete, I wait for complete timeout. I wrote that, and it's interfacing with the Amiga timer. That's another aspect. But on classic, I think the timer is the same, timer API. So if you wanted to try and adapt this to classic, then you shouldn't hardly change anything.
Anybody in the room willing to do that for cash? Or attempt to?
I'm sick of it, so someone please. Somebody else.
Not you.
Here's my print kernel repeat. I just, no, if you're on classic, you don't have debug printf, but you've got something. I don't know. Just replace it, you're done.
Or stub it out, yeah.
Yeah, stub it out even. You could make printk do nothing. But that's a Linux function, printk. Just replace it. I didn't even think of adapting it to classic. Go ahead.
You'd probably be pretty bloaty on, you know, anything that wasn't an 040 or an 060, right? But
I don't know. I mean,
as long as you...
The framework doesn't do a lot of work as long as there's no errors.
Right.
Error handling's a bitch on this framework. But as long as you're having clean transactions, you might not even notice much. Because it's all interrupt DMA driven. Right? As long as if you're polling though, you're gonna get killed. You don't want to poll anything. So whatever chip you're playing with, make sure it doesn't have a polling interface. On a classic machine, that's kind of an aside. But I found you can get away with a lot. I've been sloppy. I didn't make it perfectly streamlined or anything. And I thought, oh, this is gonna hit my performance now. No, those disks are so slow. Relatively slow,
right?
You don't notice anything. You don't notice any degradation in speed. It's amazing. I was pessimistic, and it came out, holy cow, I'm getting 3 gigabytes per second. It does work, and that's the lazy version, right? I haven't done any optimization, nothing optimized.
Very nice.
Yeah.
So when do you think this will be released, roughly? Can you get an estimate? I know we're going to
get my ass here finished.
Huh?
I'm finished moving house. So.
Okay, so relatively soon.
Yeah. Okay. I got my workstation set up. I just got to get back to it.
Okay.
Get my daughter away from me.
Great.
If I could get free babysitting, man.
Well, flying to Calgary might be a bit pricey, but.
Well, not for me. I don't see the problem.
Well, I look forward to going to the
so. But of course, you know, if you want to see pieces, I just don't want to get the whole package. Okay, well, it's lunchtime. So let's have lunch. Gentlemen, yeah. Any questions? Any more questions?
No. Are we going to go back to drivers?
No, we're going to do keyboard acceleration next. What?
There's the open question, of course, if the templates work for printer drivers.
Sorry?
If Jamie's templates work for printer drivers.
Printer drivers? Well, printer drivers aren't drivers.
It's totally different. Okay. They're not devices, I think, what you mean to say.
It's called that.
Yeah, they are.
No, they're not. They're
no,
not,
they're not.
They're not I/O devices.
They're not I/O devices.
Even if they're not called that.
It's just labeled that. Yeah.
There's actually documentation on this on the wiki, but I think they use like a line printer or something as an example to how to write a quote unquote driver for printer device.
Yeah, nobody writes a printer driver. Just get a template from the manufacturer, plug it in and go, right? For cups or whatever.
Well, you wish.
if it was that easy, right, then we have it here.
Yeah.
And it turns out that that's just not the
case. I know. Well, I have a PostScript printer, so I don't really care.
It works-ish. But the problem is just because you have a PostScript printer doesn't mean you can actually use a lot of it. So, for example,
and it prints documents. I don't know what else is there to use.
Well, does it do double-sided?
Yeah.
Double-sided print?
Yeah.
Does it do collating? Does it do stapling? Does it do all the stuff that might include print? Machine will do? Huh?
Not everyone has that.
I'm not rich.
So? Neither am I.
But you've got access. This is a nice noise.
Everyone's settled on their own. I love this. Power. Dance. Dance.
No
response. Oh, okay. Daniel,
hear me.
I can't pronounce your last name properly.
Daytona. 5, 6.
Daytona. I love it.
Daniel Daytona.
Daniel Daytona is going to.
Former motorcycle circuit.
He's going to go through some 8.12.22 optimizations, porting experiences, that kind of stuff. So we're going to focus on the 12.22 though.
Yeah.
Okay. So, take it away.
So, you all know of my the little incident I had. Actually, I wanted to present something different, maybe talk about 12.57 and how I optimized it. So, won't happen, so I came up with this other project.
Yeah, that's my wife.
What about that?
What's the transaction for that?
I made the presentation this morning, so it's probably not the most beautiful PowerPoint you ever saw, but it should do.
Vinotech.
So, let's see.
Yeah, Vinotech is a restaurant. We had a restaurant.
Yeah. The main problem with the table problem is that it's got a different floating point unit compared to our other next generation systems. And while the thing itself is pretty well, actually, I made some measurements on my own and found it to be with standard metrics, mathematics, or the usual multiplications, additions, and stuff like that. it's only slightly slower than the 746.
Oh, thank you. Okay.
And with some commands like, for example, conversion between float int and vice versa, it's sometimes, or it's usually faster. So it boils down to the same performance, more or less, as long as you work natively, as long as the code is actual SPD code. And, well, yeah, in addition to that, it also has the feature of simple synth features. It's in theory, it can calculate do some calculations on two values in parallel. But okay, that's beyond what we're talking about, and I didn't try to exploit that yet, but it's there, so maybe we could use that to somehow screw up some other stuff. Yeah, as it says, what's the big deal? It sounds like a good solution. Yeah, the incompatibility. It's simply binary incompatible. If you run FBU, compiled executables on the table, it simply could crash. And vice versa, of course. I mean, SPE compiled executables won't work on other systems. The next problem is that there is compiler support for this SPE unit in later GCC C compilers. I, for myself, use the current GCC 5 whatever version. At this point, a big thank you to the guys who take care that those tools exist for our platform. They managed to create a repository. Even I am able to compile. So I'm really bad at Linux stuff and everything. So, but I did manage it, so it means something. But well, the problem is that that we somehow to use FPU heavy code on the table, we have to somehow make it compatible, and there are several options. This was the first one. The Thomas Friedman implemented it, as far as I know. It's simply. It's an emulation layer. Whenever the execution steps into a SPE, into an old FPU instruction that the table doesn't know, it will result in a trap, and emulation code will take over and make things happen. This works actually very well. It's very reliable, but it's slow as hell. And the next iteration improvement was, or is, to patch the executable prior to execution. So during loading, the executable scans for FPU instructions, and some trampoline code is injected instead that implements every instruction in SPE native code. So this is obviously much faster, but still is not enough, unfortunately, for FPU heavy stuff. Like, for example, if you want to play the latest Quake 3 version or whatever, it's simply not enough. That leads us to the last option, recompiling. Yeah, recompiling has its own problems, namely that you need the source code, first of all. Sometimes it's harder. There may be some older programs floating around, nobody has a source code at hand. Besides that, the GCC5's SPE support is not that good. Apparently, nobody cares too much about this type of CPUs, so it's simply, sometimes it simply produces garbage. With Tower 57, it was always a matter of luck in 50% of the cases, the executable would just work. In the other 50%, it would crash on something, just like that. Sometimes it misaligns things. I don't know. I gave up. I tried, played around with tons of compilers, settings. Some work better. Some seemed to solve the issues, but ultimately, anyway, it's possible. I already talked about all that. That happens if you write a presentation in the morning. Exactly. One issue with recompilation is also that it rarely doesn't end with the respective program itself. I mean, 99% of our programs rely on other libraries, and those have to be recompiled too. Sometimes it depends. It's only critical as far as floats are used. If you use a library that doesn't use floats, then or they don't pass floats by value, then it's no issue. That's the main problem. SP and the FPU variants of the PC differ not just in the instruction set itself, but also in a little detail, namely that the FPU registers don't exist on the SPE. The SPE does everything with GPRs, so. And that's where the problem arises, that a program compiled for standard FPU simply speaks a different language than a library compiled for SPE, and vice versa. The moment you try to use a function that expects a float as parameter or returns a float as parameter, in the FPU world, in the standard FPU world, those parameters would be filled into some FPU registers, and then the function would be jumped to. In the SPE, those same values have to be put into some GPRs instead. So it's simply a different thing, it doesn't match. So if you start calling standard FPU function from SPE compiled code, it's just pure randomness. More or less pure, we'll come to that. That language that's called an ABI, application binary interface. It's simply the description of how functions are called. First parameter, it needs to be put into that register, or does it need to be put into the stack? It's simply the definition of the interface. Important to note is that it's really only critical for functions that pass floats by value. Everything else in the ABI is identical. So you can call a function that just expects some integers or so, whatever, that's no problem. Only if there's a float and only if it's by value, then it's a problem, because floats by value are expected to be in FPU registers. If you pass floats as pointers to the actual data or by reference, then it's not an issue. The Warp3D library, for example, there's no problem, because every float, actually doubles as far as I remember, are passed by as pointers to the values. So even the original standard FPU environment, the parameters aren't passed via registers because they are not passed by values. So that's you could take a game that's using Warp3D directly, that it would work. Problem is with mini GL, that's a different story. it's full of functions that expect floats by value. So nothing that uses MiniGL works. Or if you lose the MiniGL library compiled for a standard FPU on the table and a program compiled for standard FPU, then the emulation will kick in and fix everything, but it's of course insane, so it's no option. So this is an example of what will happen if you try to use a pretty simple function like printf. I mean, it's an amateur would probably think, oh, there's no floating point stuff involved. What the hell? And maybe you would think that the parameters are passed over the stack in place of printf, but unfortunately, all that is not the case. And this is what you got if you compile this program on the table for SPE, but link it against a new lib or whatever compiled for FPU. So that's an example for the problem. You have to compile everything to the same kind of ABI so that it works. Here's let's explain in more detail what's happening in this case. Then the program is compiled for SPE, as it says, the X will end up in a GPR, but the function that's being on the printf expects it to be in a float register. So the library then tries to do anything with that float register. That float register doesn't exist. The command to access the float register doesn't exist. So the emulation layer is activated, which looks in this software set of emulated registers and picks the value that's still in there from whenever. And that's something I think.
Just a quick question so I understand. The current runtime emulation layer that we're using, how does that work? Is it just when we get an exception from the processor to an invalid opcode, he says, okay,
yeah,
wait,
exactly.
Go back to whatever was in
exactly.
the program
counter
and do a lookup.
Okay.
All right. I'm just kind of curious as to what that is.
So, and the registers, the not existing registers are simply
he's got some
internal array
yeah.
where all this stuff is simply scoring it like that. Yeah, MiniGL is a good example something that really gets slow if it's emulated. So it was, of course, an interesting thing to try to circumvent all these problems. What can be done to make it fast with relative low effort and without having to recompile the original game? That was the idea. What has to be done? Take normal grade 3. Don't recompile it, and how can we get a MiniGL library that can communicate with the standard FPU build of Quake 3 and still be fast? So to achieve this, we know why it's slow. The first point, that was the idea. Have parts of MiniGL be compatible to the one API, and the internal time-consuming stuff, where all the calculations of the 3D vertices, etc., happens, have that in native SPE code. So the problem is how to marry both worlds. Yeah. And this was solved the following way. I identified all critical functions in MiniGL. Like I said, it's the functions that somehow interact with floats as values. I identified those and divided those into an inner and an outer part. The outer part, public to the world, would be compiled for standard FPU, so that other programs can attach, talk to it. Those that visible stuff is just it's just simple functions that collect the float values, put it into a global array internally to leave to get it out of the critical registers, and then jump to the inner implementation, which is compiled for SPE. This would then take the stored FPU data, which is now inside some RAM area inside where no FPU registers are involved anymore, and get it back from there, and then do the normal processing. The rest of the library is compiled for SPE, so it gets best performance. That's the whole idea. I call it a bridge. It's really pretty easy. Float and double arrays are put into the OpenGL context, so you can have multiple programs doing the stuff in parallel. It's volatile, so that no fancy compiler things. Oh, it's totally redundant what he does. Let's optimize it away. That is it. Unfortunately, it's not not as fast, usually not as fast as I thought it was. But that's likely because there are other parts involved. Take Quake 3, for example. It became much faster by that, but it's still too slow. This is simply because there's other stuff like emulib that needs to be tableized too, so every time Quake 3's logic internally does some trigonometry functionality or whatever for its AI or name it, it's always been going through the emulation again. So I couldn't only catch one bottleneck. But it depends. Some games may just work fluently all of a sudden. Well, it's one brick. Better than nothing, but still it's a long way to go. But in principle, what I did here, you can use the same approach for almost every critical library you can think of. Doing the same thing for Newlib, for example, is, well, just a matter of a bit of time, passion, who wants? Yeah, and
so that's huge. Newlib is gigantic. How much of that is actual floating point operations?
I assume it's not too much.
Not too much.
But I took a look at Newlib. It's as I said at the beginning, I'm not that good with big open source ugly code messes, and Newlib, at least when I first looked at it, had that smell. I would say there are people that are better suited for that task, and it's really not hard, but we'll see. My lovely editor that I identified during lunch or a bit earlier, which are the critical files where I did changes, and I will now go through all of them and show you what I did and that it's really not that much. First of all, I came up with some files. Yeah. Guess what? There are different flavors how to compile that library now. Of course, you can compile it for standard FPU like before. Then then you can compile it completely for SPE, so that it's for use for, so that SPE compiled games can use a completely SPE compiled library. That's of course the best case, yes, performance wise. And then you can compile it with a bridge, so that FPU compiled existing games can use it. And well, those are the compiler defines. You usually put it into the make file and to be done with it. The next step was to do some little adjustments here and there. This, for example, to read the timer on the SPE is slightly different than on other power PCs. So yeah, okay. I guess Thomas Fried came up with this solution. I just entered it here. You will find some little changes like that at several places, but it's not much. For example, here is another one. Here, the original had some inline assembly. For simplicity, I simply exchanged them with some trivial C stuff for now. You could make it more beautiful, certainly, but I was too lazy. So it does the job. This is that it simply compiles and works. It's nothing special. Same thing here. The mini JS source is, you can see that it's work of several years and several people, and it's a bit, things are sometimes a bit cluttered around, and okay. So basically, a handful of if devs to get rid of existing PowerPC inline assembly and so on. That was it until here. This here is the context struct of MinGL. Yeah. And I simply added my little tiny arrays I talked about. I don't need more than 6 and floats and not more than 9 doubles in case of MinGL. So here it is. This is where the floats, the bridge catches, are stored temporarily. MiniGL actually consists out of two libraries. There is this OpenGL utility library, GLUT. It's more or less integrated here, so I did the same thing for this GLUT library too. It's the same thing. Forget about it, just to have said it. So now somehow the here we have something else. I will tell you about that later. Just clean up for me. Okay. Now here I make myself a convenient header file where rerouted some of the standard functions to my own implementations. So, like I said, often it's not enough to just have one library or one executable to be SPE-fied. It may also be that there are new lib calls to mass functions and so on and so on. And in case of MiniGL, I chose not to fight with newlib or whatever, but instead simply integrate SPE variants of those functions you see here to not need to work through yet another lib. I simply took what I needed from newlib or wrote some stuff from scratch, put it in there in one file, and be done with it. So I avoided all the other overhead of the new library. So it's this year is the most important stuff. Now the idea, as I described, is to have special outer public functions that replace the previous ones to simply catch the float parameters. And those pre-functions have, of course, been called by the client. So they must replace the current real implementation that's usually called. So we came up with a few defines here, those, to make life easier. If you look here at the mini-GL vectors table, so the point where, I guess you already see it, that's the function table of the library. And I identified all functions that are critical. For example, this one here, GL clear color, it's critical because it expects 4 float parameters. GL clamp is just a defined time depth for float. I did that. I identified all those functions and simply added this little define in front of it. And this means that all those functions get a different name. Yeah, so that was how I injected my own stuff into the existing function table without too much hassle. I mean, it's pretty easy to do it that way. So, the same thing for good. Like I said, it's basically two libraries I handled here, but it's the same. So, the actual implementation of those catch functions here, let's take this one. This define, or here's now the implementation of the function I just patched into the jump table. And as you can see, actually nothing happens here. I get the context struct. This define here means put this float value into cell 1 of my float array. Yeah, this helper array I use to get the float out of the register, and then call the original function, or not exactly the original function minus its float parameters. Because if you look at the inner variant here, same thing, only the other side. Here, this define will mean the opposite. It will mean just access the value. Yeah? So, as you can see, the original clear depth function expects a float, namely the value of the clear depth. This is caught here, put into the table, then the inner function is called here, and this one gets it out of the table and calls the real original mini-GL function. This file here is compiled for SPE. This file is for standard SPE. That's the whole magic behind it. And as you can see, it's a joke. I mean, it's a really, really trivial to achieve. It's just need some time. But other than that, it's trivial work. And yeah, all those functions look identical. They only differ in the amount of floats I push and pop around. That's essentially it. Actually, that's it. No, happy problem.
So, Newland.
Yeah.
It has the same kind of trampolines in it. Every function goes through all those stuff. So we could do the same kind of tricks.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, because it's the same trick.
Yeah, you can use the same
trick. So you don't lose your ABI compatibility.
Exactly.
You can use the old ABI, and then underneath you can sub in all the magic.
Of course, it's still slower than having everything compiled for SP. I mean, this stuff here introduces some overhead, of course.
Otherwise, you have to compile newlib with SPE, and then the ABI breaks. So you have newlib tabor and newlib normal.
Yeah. Right. But ultimately, but
isn't that what used to happen? No, we used to get programs that would get the version one, the regular version, and the FPU version in the really, and we didn't even have to have FPUs back then.
I really don't recommend going down that path. If you think about the number of things that relies on newlib, it's enormous.
Yes.
It's enormous, and you don't know what they're going to use. And the last thing you want to do is
it's just a couple.
I mean,
dude.
I mean, what I did here, collecting the necessary functions and put them inside. It's just because I was lazy.
Yeah.
It shouldn't be done that way. By the way, I did the same thing more or less for Tower 57. I stuffed everything inside, and I didn't have any more dependencies I couldn't control too well, or which would have meant to waste yet more months or weeks. We should have some solution to have a full SPE newlib in any way, or a special version of it, but not start stripping stuff and putting it into all executables here and there, and you need some solution for some sort of maybe
it's hybrid
to handle. Either it's hybrid or really to have multiple lib variants, and the library loader selects the right one, whatever, something like that.
Oh, that's true. You could have a detector.
One possible idea would be to have an interface. A version of the main interface that is.
Yeah, that was the whole point of having interfaces in the first place.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
That was the whole reason we had interfaces.
So you have the main interface, and you have main underscore SPE or something like that.
Yeah. Sometimes the things are so obvious.
So obvious. We shouldn't do that.
but
use the interface for what it's for. And then those modules that want to use the SPE-enabled newlib or whatever.
Well, actually, you could put all three variants, the FPU, the hybrid, and the SPE.
Yeah.
You could make it three interfaces.
Yeah.
Why not?
You'd have one without FPU, no FPU version.
Mm-hmm. Also, you could have a version.
So the overhead is primarily just a few loads in the store command. That's all it is.
Of course, of course. But still, it may sum up. I mean,
it depends on what the actual function is doing.
If you have a program that's mostly using old school OpenGL, GL begin, GL end, blah blah blah. Okay, those programs are slow per se anyway, but they won't become faster by that. So, but it's of course nothing compared to the emulation.
Right. Just the exception handling alone, you're talking.
Of course. During one such exception, the link passing, you have finished.
Takes forever.
Half of the frame.
And it's every single instruction it hits.
Yeah.
This is pretty sweet. I have to tell you, this is very creative. I was not expecting the solution. I was expecting something far more complicated.
Yeah, it's really.
This is great.
Maybe shovel the
arguments into storage and take them back out. We're done.
Maybe the most ugly part is the make file.
The make file,
Quick question about the glue code. Did you ask Thomas about getting direct access to the emulated?
No, I did not.
Because I'm just thinking the only way you might be able to get slight more performance would be to skip that copy into your own local array. But that would mean somehow getting direct access to the fake registers.
But I didn't ask. Yeah. I was pretty happy with the results and then.
For sure. Because I originally thought this would take a lot more time, MiniGL, and then suddenly you said you'd done it.
Yeah, but
it's a genius.
No, the other MiniGL variant, you know, the re-implementation on Nova, that's something that will take a bit long. but this, I mean, it's just about, getting some small translation in between.
Yeah,
the main file, I have to be honest, I simply copied the original one and stuffed some extra flags in. It looks as ugly as the original one, but basically, well, you have sections for the SPE stuff. Let me search. SPE full native is a bad example. I prepared it for the eventual time somebody came up with a new limit. I found those flags to work rather well. What is the optimization flags and the SPE flags to work to produce reliable code most often.
The unsafe math is good. It's good.
Yeah, that's
nice. Unsafe math.
Those
are good.
Those are
pretty safe, man.
Even minus 0.4 is fine. I can recommend those. So here we got the
nomads.
The code that will be. Here. You see? MGL source public. That's the public interface. That's the files which are compiled for standard FPU.
So again, you can use the interface mechanism to make an SDE interface version.
Yeah.
And then you don't have to do the EBI swap. But you always end up doing somewhere. Like you said, because there's so many libraries.
No, it depends. You need that mechanism, that translation mechanism. The moment you want an FPU compile program, use SPE functionality. You need a bridge. No matter if you use the library interface mechanism to offer the functionality, but the bridge has to be there.